are reviewing now. If I was for this class, I would review now. So Friday is your final, and it's going to be in this room. We'll have an hour and a half to take it. Fun and games, right? Okay. So we did this slide, and I think it's kind of cool because in astronomy, when we talked about the Earth, I think we talked about the layers of the Earth a little bit and layers of other terrestrial planets kind of have the same theme going. They have a core, they have a mantle, they have a crust. Now, we're going to kind of break those down a little bit more in this chapter. So the crust, okay, covers the entire Earth. I know it sounds kind of silly, but actually underneath those large bodies of water, there is crust too. And we'll be talking about the oceanic crust versus the crust that's under the oceans versus the crust that's on the continents. They are different. And actually, this is a term that made it to your final exam. There's a topic over this. So if you want to put a little star on this slide, you can, because this is on your final in some sense. So the ocean crust, and I think the video we watched on Friday talked about this. The ocean crust is thinner, but it's denser. And if you've probably heard of the term basalt before, that's kind of associated with volcanoes, I think. Okay. So here we have a picture. These kind of gray or brown-looking things, those are both Earth's crust. Of course, under the crust, we have the mantle. You can kind of see the mantle there. And I like what your author's done is you can kind of see the dense particles are close together for the ocean. So for the continental crust, it's a little sparser. It's a little lighter. It's less dense. Instead of being basalt, it's granite. So actually, we've had three rocks now, haven't we? We'd have, was it igneous? Okay, basalt and granite. So actually, I'm going to talk about three rocks. So here's a table to kind of compare the two. In general, the continental crust is a fair piece older, okay, than the crust that's under the oceans. Okay, we already kind of talked about how thick it is. You can see that actually the coast that's on land, or excuse me, the crust that's on land is thicker than the ocean crust. Okay, the ocean crust is denser. They're made up of different things. So one of the things I do is I kind of post all my lectures out there. I post them on our YouTube so anybody can listen to them. And every once in a while I'll get a comment from people. And one of the comments I've got recently from some random person out there, probably a student trying to, taking a class that lectures would help them, is how do you know these things? How do you know the, like, the composition of the layers of a planet, for instance, as you go inward? And that's actually coming up on the next slide. But breaking down kind of the layers of the Earth's interior, actually between the mantle and the crust, we have this discontinuity layer called the Mohorovicic. I can't pronounce that. Okay, so the mantle is under the crust. The mantle actually has a couple of different types of kind of textures to it. The mantle is about 80% of the Earth's volume and 2/3 of its mass. So this is probably what I would tell that student if he was mine, but whatever, I usually don't respond to anybody who posts on my videos, my lecture videos. I figure if they get too bad or derogatory, I'll just pull all my videos. Nobody has to watch them. So anyway, how do we know the interior of a planet? Seismology data, basically earthquakes and that sort of thing, basically looking at energy as it travels. We can study meteorites. Remember, those are space rocks, to get a sense for the interior of our planet. And also, as material comes out from the center of our planet via volcanoes, that we understand our planet. So this is looking at seismology. Basically, each one of those kind of lines is a ray of energy. And depending upon what it passes through, the nature of what it passes through, the density and the liquid versus solid, it will be deflected or pass in different ways. So with regard to the core now, there are actually two parts to the core. There is the solid inner part, and then there's the ooey gooey kind of, it's almost like an amniotic fluid that the core is spinning around in. And it's fortunate for us that the core actually has a liquid outer part, because it's that liquid outer part that actually it plays a key role in giving us our important magnetosphere, magnetic field. I was going to, by the way, I'll go back here. I was going to click The Core. Like, there's a movie called The Core, and that was actually just a little trailer from The Core. It's a good kind of, gosh, was it, like, late 80s film. It's science fiction. It's funny. Okay. So, looking a little bit closer at the layers of the interior of the Earth, there's this layer called the asthenosphere, and I like that word. Asthenosphere kind of reminds me of aesthetics. Okay. Actually, the asthenosphere is the top part of the mantle. And if you put the asthenosphere and the lithosphere together, I think we talked about the lithosphere before. The lithosphere, if you want to put a little star on this slide, lithosphere is also on your comprehensive vinyl. Okay. So when we talk about plate tectonics coming up in a minute, to me, the lithosphere and the asthenosphere are big players, because the asthenosphere is kind of this kind of rubbery sort of part top to the mantle, and the lithosphere basically is kind of the crust, the plates that are going to move around on the asthenosphere. There's not much going on. To me, it's weird how, like, Earth scientists kind of break up their layers of the Earth's interior. Okay. Oops. So I think the video talked about how it's been a while now since people have been creating maps, that they start to look at like the land masses and see where they kind of fit together like a jigsaw puzzle. And so, of course, you see North America, South America, Africa, and Europe, okay, and you kind of slide those two together. And it's true that there is evidence that actually that all of the land mass, which is about only about a quarter of the Earth's surface, three quarters is covered with large bodies of water. But all the land masses used to be one big chunk called Pangaea. Okay, so this is kind of showing how they split apart. And so this idea of land masses, because the lithosphere is broken up into chunks, they actually have been drifting ever since, and they still are drifting. Okay, and that's how we got large continents to be at different locations. So the video, I think, did a good job of this. Remember, igneous rock is kind of like the very oldest rock that was, as the Earth just, after it was like totally molten and started to cool down some 4-point-something billion years ago. Actually, I think here it goes. Those little arrows there are little, those little arrows are like little kind of magnetic poles in the rocks, okay? So remember that the rock was molten, okay? And so basically, however the Earth's poles were, the little magnetic poles in the rocks responded to that. And so that's actually kind of, it's kind of, is a snapshot. It's frozen in time for posterity. If you've ever seen the movie Ice Age, okay, and, you know, to think about the animals that were frozen, I mean, just where they are doing what they were doing, that's kind of what we have here in the rocks. So one of the things is that looking at rocks and looking at kind of how the, and it's usually, I think, iron atoms within probably the iron-containing rocks were frozen, they actually can see that they were directed at different directions. So, of course, when we talk about sedimentary rock, this would be the oldest, okay, and this would be the youngest up here, layer of rock. And so as it was deposited, you can see, well, these, the poles was the same way. These, the poles was different. These, the poles are, again, going back to the way they were, you know, two layers ago. And so like the slide says, these are actually, it was molten at the time it came out of the volcano and froze according to whatever the Earth's poles was at the time. So 22 times, okay, we can actually see the Earth flipping its poles. I can't remember, I've got some videos. I don't think this video works for me. Let's see. these days, probably people don't have to be convinced of this idea of our lithosphere is broken up, our crust basically is broken up into chunks and it floats around on liquid mantle, which now we know is the asthenosphere, the part of the mantle. But one evidence actually is this thing called the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. Actually, if I put a star next to this, this actually is a term that made it to your final two. The Atlantic part comes from the Atlantic Ocean. Of course, we have a North Atlantic Ocean here on our east coast, and we have a South Atlantic Ocean here. Okay. Now, that red line actually is a place where these plates are what we say diverging. I'm going to talk about kind of what are our options for plates to do. One of them is to come apart, what we call diverge. Okay. The Mid-Atlantic Ridge, where plates are diverging. And oceanic trenches are not as exciting to me as the ridges. Okay, so seafloor spreading is creating our ridges. I think I've got this right. So the way the seafloor, that's like, how do you say, Sally sells seashells by the seashore. Say that nice. The way this I think this is kind of neat, this works, is the yellow is the oldest, okay? And kind of this darkest green actually is the newest. So this is actually where the liquid from the interior of the Earth is oozing up. Two plates are, what I say, diverging with a D, okay? And so basically you have old, okay, and you have young here. Like this slide says that actually your thickest is going to be your yellow, your oldest ocean crust, okay? This is under the Atlantic Ocean. I think that's pretty cool. Sea floor spreading. Okay. And this actually just kind of talks more about sea floor spreading. Okay. This is kind of showing you that the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, how it could be, how the Mid-Atlantic Ridge kind of forms. Again, the green is the oldest. Okay, you can kind of see new stuff. The purple here would be the newest. And then I mentioned, and I think the video we watched on Friday said this too, actually you can see kind of captured in these kind of, this is kind of neat. Like if we go to that last one down there, I like how they color-coded this. So this one, okay, and this one, actually they are the same age, right? And they have the same like frozen in time kind of magnetic field thing line kind of showing you. I think that is so cool. Okay, so lithosphere, remember, is going to be on your final exam. Lithosphere is kind of the crust the plate tectonics relies on. So here we have kind of the Frankenstein stitching together of the Earth's crust again, kind of showing you where the breaks in the plates are. This tsunami footage, I looked at it this morning, and the link that I showed my students previously isn't available. If you've ever seen footage of something that is just terrible like this, what I was thinking was the 2004 tsunami in India. Yeah, I just couldn't show it this morning. It's just like, because it says, you know, warning, you know, it's got, you know, people who perished shown on film, and that just wasn't going to happen this morning. But one of the things, I don't even know if it's on my PowerPoint slides, that I would love for you guys to know, is tsunamis have nothing to do with the weather. Tsunamis, say it with me, nothing to do with the weather, okay? Tsunamis have to do with actually this idea of plate tectonics, okay? So the tsunami that hit India, so the thing about tsunamis is they are associated with two plates creating an earthquake. And I have a slide coming up to talk a little bit about earthquakes, since here in Iowa we don't deal much with earthquakes. I'll go ahead and kind of circle the somewhere in this green circle was the 2004 tsunami event. So basically what happens is you have a large body of water. Underneath that large body of water, you have plate activity. Basically, you have an abrupt kind of bump, okay? It's probably created by, like I said, kind of plates moving alongside of each other. And what that does is it disturbs the liquid water on top of it. And you're like, eh, that's not too bad. Well, it is if basically you're near kind of the coast of something. Because that bump to the water, it's that bump that creates a humongous wave that ultimately creates what we call a tsunami. So the footage I watched today for a little bit, actually, tsunamis happen on beautifully blue days where everybody's in the water. No, I don't know about that. The thing about the tsunami that I had forgotten until I saw this morning, but basically, if you figure that little that bump that's going to lift up the water, well, think of it as lifting up the water. And so actually what they saw first was basically the water went out. So it's all of a sudden they're like, are you serious? Like, you know how we all like to pick up seashells? I haven't been to the coast for a very often time, many times, but when the tide is out, you pick up seashells. Well, picture the tide basically going out, 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 out. And you're like, oh my gosh, this is not time for the tide to go out. Okay, where'd all the water go? And you can see the tourists going, way, you know, look at all these seashells, okay? But basically that tide was going out in preparation for then basically the chunk of water was going to come in. So if you're ever a tourist somewhere, and I know the video I watched said the natives were like hightailing it, you know, I think during that tsunami, I don't think there was any place to go on the island that was necessarily safe. But the tide went out, and so tsunamis associated with this. All right. So diverging, let's see, yeah, did I say diverging? Diverging with the D, that actually created, as I understand it, the seafloor spreading that creates our Mid-Atlantic Ridge. We can also have plates that are coming together, and we call that converging plates. Okay. And then transform must be maybe the side to side. We'll see. Transforming. Okay, so diverging plate boundaries. Okay, creates our Mid-Atlantic ridges. Ridge. I mean, it makes sense to me. Right? So notice that actually we can have kind of a ridge of material created, or we can have volcanic activity along there. Okay, how about converging plates? Two plates that are moving towards each other. Well, you definitely still have some options there with plates moving towards each other. One option is that actually one plate goes under the other plate, okay, and I think the video talked about this, and we call that actually, that place is what we call the subduction zone. The rock that goes down actually is melted again, which I think is pretty exciting. It's part of the rock cycle, okay, and then the stuff that's on top of the subduction zone, actually that can actually kind of build up and create kind of a mountain area. Okay, so possibilities with regard to types of crust that are converging. We can have a continental and an ocean plate converging. We can have two ocean plates converging. We can have two continental plates converging. And there's a slightly different option what happens with each. This first one is where you have an ocean current, you have an ocean crust being subducted, okay, by a see the mountain building here, potential for volcanoes there. I always want to look at this, and I think I'm wrong, though. I always want to look at this and kind of think of our West Coast, because when I think of California and stuff like that, I think of like the, they're the Rockies over here, but then over here is the chain of mountains. But, have you ever heard, like, California is going to fall off into the ocean? I have, too. So there's something to be said for that. Some would say that's a good thing. I don't think it is. Okay, what if you have two ocean plates that are converging? Okay, so it looks kind of similar to what we saw before. This is the subduction zone right here, where actually this material goes and melts and part of the rock cycle. And this actually is built up here. We can have volcanoes create islands here. Oops. You guys don't have any words to fill in, do you? Mm-hmm. You might think, well, you know our Hawaiian islands, their chain of Hawaiian islands, you might think, well, I bet this is what's happening. But like the video said, I think the video we watched said, that actually our Hawaiian islands are created by a plate moving over a hot spot. Okay, so I think that's kind of cool too. They aren't created along a boundary like this. Okay, then the last one, we have converging plates, but we have there are two continents, okay? So you can't have anything, I guess you could have a subduction zone. But here we have these two continental plates coming together, and they actually created the Himalayas. So if you want to put a little star next to this, this I think is actually maybe the last term that you'll see on your review sheet for Unit 5. And that's kind of exciting, I think. Yeah. So transformation boundaries are the side-by-side. Okay. And those will give you earthquakes. So an example of this sort of situation with plate movement would be along California. All right. So there's still questions remaining. We talked about the asthenosphere being kind of the slick thing that the lithosphere is moving around on. Okay. What is creating kind of that movement? And I think back in astronomy unit, we talked about this kind of convection cells within the Earth's mantle. Basically, warm liquid mantle is rising, it cools down, okay, and then it falls back down. So actually, as my hands are here, these are two convection cells that actually help drive the movement of the lithosphere on top of them. It's just a busy slide. Is this your last slide? Mm-hmm. Cool. Yay! Okay. So that's all I have for today. And then on Wednesday, I think the next thing I'd like to talk about, and I'll bring slides, is like the types of rocks and stuff. So if you have any questions, or if I don't...